Ok, allora, who remembers the definition of eigenvalues? Eigenvectors and eigenvalues. So, we start with the matrix A square. We start with the real matrix. So, what is an eigenvector and an eigenvalue? If you remember, you have to satisfy this equation. So, mu should be a vector different from zero, different from the null vector. And instead, the eigenvalue is a number. But the problem, actually, this is not, this should be Cn. Why? You remember that from this you can get this. Should be sent to zero by this matrix. So this means that V is in the kernel of A minus lambda I. I is the identity matrix. And then by the theorem of Ruscha-Capelli, you get with this hypothesis, this is if and only if the determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to zero. Okay? So the eigenvalues of the matrix can be computed by computing the roots of this equation. This is an algebraic equation of so-called secular equation, has many names. This is the characteristic polynomial is equal to zero, and the roots of the characteristic polynomials are the eigenvalues. So you get this result, lambda is an eigenvalue A if and only if the determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to zero. And so this is the reason we can, so this is a polynomial. You know that polynomials are not obliged to have roots or in R. Roots can be, even if polynomial is with coefficient in R, you can have roots in Z. You can have, of course, if coefficients are real, you have that if there is one root, there should be also the conjugate root. Okay? Gli autovalori sono le radici polinomio caratteristiche. Ovviamente, anche se A è reale, poi A potremmo metterla pure a valori complessi, questo polinomio caratteristico viene reale. E quindi in quel caso, se ci avete un autovalore complesso dovete avere per forza anche
il complesso.
Complesso unitario. Everything is clear?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. Then, and this is the reason we search for eigenvalues in CN and eigenvalues in C and eigenvectors in CN. Because it can be, can happen. Of course, if this is in, it's not real, this cannot be real, because otherwise the equation cannot be fulfilled. Okay. Why? First of all, okay, I understand this is first year matter, but I want to recall it because it's important. Why eigenvalues and eigenvectors are so important? So you know of them because you mostly you met some problem in your research, and I need to put you these eigenvalues. I need to put you these eigenvectors. But why they are so important? Okay, I briefly recall the problem of diagonalization of a matrix. So you have a vector space V, you have a linear. Let us say that this dimension of V is equal to dimension of W and is equal to F. Okay? And F is a linear function. So you know that if you take a vector V here, this corresponds, you can fix a base B in this space, and every vector has coordinates. Then if you apply F, you will get F of B, this is W, and then you will get its coordinates. Let us assume for one moment that W is equal to V. So, in this case, we have what is called endomorphisms. Endomorphism. Because this is a linear application from V into V. Okay? Then, it is natural to fix here the same base, because it's same space, it's not natural to fix a different base. Okay? Then, by linearity of V, of F, you can make a very quick computation, and you will find that the coordinates of the image of V via F, they are given by the multiplication of X, the coordinates of V, by a fixed matrix A. This matrix depends on F and on the fixed base. Ripeto brevemente in italiano. Voi ci avete un endomorfismo, un'applicazione lineare da V in V. Io fisso una base allo spazio di partenza, la base allo spazio di arrivo è lo stesso, quindi la base sarà la stessa, non c'ha senso fissarne una diversa. Allora, cosa succede naturalmente fissata la base, applicare F a V o applicare A, moltiplicare X per A per la matrice A a livello di coordinate è la stessa cosa. Questo è, avete fatto in, al primo anno di università. Now, what happens if I change this? Ok? So I can have another base, E prime, and another set of coordinates, X prime. Here, of course, I fix the same base, E prime, and I get the new coordinates in the new place, way prime. So, is called the matrix, in Italian is matrice di passaggio. The matrix that this matrix is the one that you have to multiply the new coordinates in order to get the old coordinates. And then here you will get the inverse matrix. So, composing all multiplications, you will get that way prime is m to the minus 1 a m x prime. So, when I update my base, everything is just the same. Besides the fact that I have to change my, update my matrix A in this way. Okay? And I'm forced to update in this way. So if I multiply here by a matrix M, this is a metric matrix, of course. And here I have to multiply by the inverse matrix. Okay. So the natural question is, can we find some things that are invariant for the function f independently of the fixed basis b or b prime? So, something that is not dependent on coordinates, okay? This is important. And this can also give an answer to, can I fix a basis, E prime, here, in order that this matrix would be as simple as possible? Quindi ci sono due domande naturali. Prima di tutto, ci sta, siccome qua quando cambio base cambia la matrice, ci sta qualche cosa che non cambia al variare della base, qualcosa che rimane costante. Primo. Secondo, in questo caso, può aiutarmi questa, diciamo, questi invarianti possono aiutarmi a rendere questa matrice il più semplice possibile? In una base opportuna, okay? So now we remember the definition of eigenvalue. Okay? So we try to get to compute the eigenvalues of the new matrix. So we, this is characteristic polynomial of the Newton matrix. But here I can multiply by n to the minus 1 and m because it's identity. So then I can put m to the minus 1, it multiplies both of this, and then on the right side I can do the same thing. And then I can apply Binet theorem. Binet theorem says that the determinant of the product of matrices is the product of the determinants. So I have the determinant of m to the minus 1, but this is the reciprocal of this. And then I have the whole determinant, whole characteristic polynomial, and then I have this determinant. Then this simplifies, and I get that characteristic polynomial is imaginary. Okay? This is first element. Lo ripeto in italiano. Noi dobbiamo calcolare il polinomio caratteristico della nuova matrice. Quando andiamo a calcolarlo, da queste semplici uguaglianze e dal teorema qui, usiamo il teorema di Binet, otteniamo che il polinomio caratteristico della matrice aggiornata in questo modo non cambia, è invariato. Okay. So if the characteristic polynomial doesn't change, then all eigenvalues don't change. They just stay the same. So there is one let us say we know that how many are the eigenvalues of A. I recall that dimension V is equal to n. How many are eigenvalues? If we compute them in C, they are n, exactly n. Of course, it can be that some of them are equal, repeating. But they have to be exactly n if computed in C. Why? If you remember, this characteristic polynomial is of degree n. And C is so-called closed algebraic field. So, when I equal this to zero, since algebraic equation is of degree n, there are exactly n groups. If each one is computed with its so-called multiplicity. So multiplicity means that root can appear several times. You have Ruffini's theorem, every time you get a root, you can divide lambda, you can divide this polynomial by some lambda star, you can divide this polynomial by x minus lambda star. And so, but then you have another theorem that says that C is closed. That every time you have a polynomial in C equal to zero, if it is not constant, you can find a root. So you find a root, you lower the degree by one, and so on, you find n roots. Quindi gli autovalori sono esattamente n se contati con la loro molteplicità. Non possono essere né di meno né di più. Ovviamente può capitare che un certo autovalore venga ripetuto 6 volte, per esempio, più volte. Ma devono essere esattamente n. Perché? Perché ogni volta che trovate una radice, avete il teorema di Ruffini che vi abbassa il teorema di Ruffini. E dice, ma e se la radice non la trovo, per esempio, se io avevo un polinomio di di secondo grado in R2 erano da 4 più 1 uguale a 0, i valori non ci stanno in R, ma in C ci sono, perché in C quando avete un polinomio non costante c'è sempre una radice. Teorema fondamentale dell'algebra. Fondamento del teorema. So, which is the simplest matrix with this fixed element? Okay. Which is the simplest matrix we can imagine with this fixed element? One can think, of course, diagonal matrix. Of course, this I can omit. It's not better to use the rear blackboard. This is matrix that on the main diagonal has some values, here whatever you want, and here all zeros. Okay? This is upper triangular matrix. In this case, eigenvalues, obviously, are lambda 1. This is trivial because when you subtract lambda identity, you will get that the terminal of this matrix. This is still upper triangular. It's not needed to know what there is here, but when you compute this determinant, you will get. Lambda 1 minus lambda, lambda 2 minus lambda, and so on, you multiply and you will get that this is this polynomial. When you equal this to 0, which are the roots? Lambda 2. Okay? So one can. A is a n times n square real matrix. First case. Let us assume that some of these eigenvalues are not real. Can we do this update in order that this will be diagonal, in your opinion? Why not? If we are fixing the base with real coordinates, always real coordinates, this will be real matrices. And if this will be real matrices, then if we want diagonal matrix on the diagonal is triangle, should appear eigenvalues. And if I multiply if everything is real, I cannot obtain and not feel even if I start, if I have complex arithmetic and I want to triangularize, diagonalize matrix, even if starting matrix is real, I am forced to use matrix in complex arithmetic. But this is not a big issue. This is just because if eigenvalues are real, I use real matrices. If eigenvalues mean, if eigenvalues are complex, I am forced to use complex matrices. And not real. This is not a big issue. Second case, assume that every, there will be some special case in this, this is true. Every eigenvalue is real. Okay? Assume for now that every eigenvalue is real. Can I find a couple of matrices here such that this matrix will be not triangle but diagonal with zero also up? The answer is no. In general, no. Cioè, la domanda è: se la matrice è reale e tutti gli autovalori sono reali, posso diagonalizzarla? Cioè, posso trovare una matrice, queste matrici si possono chiamare equivalenti, questa, il fatto che tra una e l'altra esista questa relazione, si può vedere che è una relazione di equivalenza. Posso trovare un'altra matrice equivalente a lei, diagonale? In generale, no. In generale, no. E adesso vi do subito la dimostrazione. I will get straightforward the proof. Let us take this matrix. Which are the eigenvalues of this matrix? It's trivial. This is triangle. You have one with multiplicity 2. Assume M minus 1 AM is equal, is diagonal. Then we know that eigenvalues are imaginary. Then M minus 1 AM is equal to what should appear? Identity. If the new matrix is diagonal, the eigenvalues should stay the same. And diagonal with 1 and 1 is identity. But this, if and only if I multiply here by m and by m minus 1, and this is, of course, not true because A was not there. Change basis in order that a matrix is diagonal in general. Okay? So now we recall a lemma. I can do it so I will use will be some special matrix, will not just be just immeasurable, will be orthogonal to each other. Okay? But before to do this, cioè, adesso andremo a dimostrare il lemma di Schur. Il lemma di Schur ti dice che in generale tu non lo puoi trovare una matrice M-1 M in maniera tale che questa venga diagonale. Non lo puoi fare. Però se gli autovalori erano tutti reali, perché se erano complessi non c'era proprio speranza di usare matrici complesse, posso trovarne due matrici tale che sia almeno triangolare. Per esempio questo è triangolare, non è la diagonale, però triangolare lo è, no? Quindi qua non devo fare niente. Ma non solo. Per farla uscire triangolare non mi serve, diciamo, posso trovare una matrice più particolare di una matrice semplicemente invertibile. Cioè il cambiamento di fase che vado a fare non deve essere per forza generale, ma potrà essere un cambiamento rigido, cioè una isometria della base. Cioè io prendo il vettore della base e li muovo in maniera rigida, conservando gli angoli del vettore. Al più farò una simmetria di un rivista, anche quella di un'isometria. Se voi prendete di quanto girata la lettera fuori, è quella, diciamo, mantiene tutte le distanze della rete. Quindi questo sì andrà a sostanziare nel fatto che andrò a scegliere per il cambiamento di fase delle matrici ortogonali. Vi chiamerò che cosa sono le matrici ortogonali, per di voi che diciamo non se lo ricordano in maniera precisa. Ok, però la cosa importante, voglio tornare, prima di vedere il risultato in positivo, voglio tornare sul risultato in negativo. Non è possibile diagonalizzare tutte le matrici. Quella là non si diagonalizzerà mai. Questa qua non si può diagonalizzare, l'abbiamo appena dimostrato. Più in generale, noi potremo vedere, però un po' più in là, un risultato che si chiama la decomposizione a forma canonica di Jordan, che dice cosa possiamo fare, perché diagonale non ci riesco, triangolare ancora, diciamo, fare qualcosa meglio di triangolare. In realtà quel risultato ti arriverà molto meglio come è fatta la struttura di una matrice. Ripeto, si chiama decomposizione a forma canonica di Jordan, però non è un risultato complicato. Io ho fatto al primo anno di università. Il problema è che è un risultato che si deve enunciare in una maniera abbastanza precisa, perché sennò ci si confonde e non si capisce che sta succedendo. Va bene. Allora, adesso io direi che facciamo la dimostrazione del lemma, richiamiamo che cos'è una matrice ortogonale, poi dimostriamo il lemma di Schur e poi facciamo la ricorda. So, now we will recall what is an orthogonal matrix. consider real matrices, matrices and complex matrices. Definition M a square n times n matrix is orthogonal if and only if by definition M minus 1 is equal to M transpose. This is equivalent to say that M transpose M is equal to I vector. Why are we interested into real orthogonal matrices? Remember that on Rn we have the usual scalar product. Assume this. So let us take two vectors, x and y. And then let us compute the scalar product of the transformer vectors. Okay. These are coordinates. So these are coordinates when I change base. But this, if you remember, is equal to x m transpose m a. When you want to take away a matrix from here, you have to move here, but you, this is simple exercise, you can do. If you want to cancel a matrix here and to put here, you can do it, but it appears the transpose matrix. Okay. But if this is equal to identity, this is equal to the old scalar product. Okay? This implies, for example, the length of the transformer vector and this is what is called an isometry. Linear isometry, because it's linear. I can also have a translation added to a linear. Basically, isometry is a rotation. Not exactly, because you can have also some symmetry, but all symmetries can be reduced to one symmetry. It depends from the fact that how much is the determinant of M here? How much? If you apply Binet, you will find that this is the determinant of M transpose that it is equal to the determinant of M. This is the determinant of M, and then this has to be 1. So you get that the square of the determinant of M is 1. So how much it can be the determinant of M? Plus or minus 1? If it is plus 1, you have a rotation. If it is minus 1, it is a rotation. After the rotation, or before rotation, depends how you compute. But just you have to take one coordinate and change the sign. It's not a big issue. But every orthogonal linear transformation saves all scalar products and all lengths. They don't change. Quindi quando prendiamo la trasformazione ortogonale, la trasformazione ortogonale non altera gli angoli tra i vettori, perché come si fa? E non altera né le lunghezze né gli angoli tra i vettori. Chi è il prodotto scalare di due vettori? La norma del primo per la norma del secondo per il coseno dell'angolo compreso. Da qui vedete che non altera le lunghezze e da qui vedete che non altera neanche. In realtà si può dimostrare, questo non lo faccio, andate a rivederlo sul testo di analisi di geometria del primo anno. Se conserva le distanze, deve conservare per forza anche i prodotti scalari. Perché se vi ricordate, se io ho la norma, il prodotto scalare canonico si può ricostruire dalla norma. Come si fa? Il prodotto scalare di x, se vi ricordate, lo scrivo qua, lo cancello. X, prodotto scalare con x. Potete fare un quarto della norma di x più y al quadrato meno la norma di x meno y al quadrato. Ok? Se qui ci mettevate in più, ottenevate da quest'altra qua, dividevate, non ci mettevate un quarto. Ottenevate 2 norma x quadro più 2 norma y quadro, quella che si chiama l'uguaglianza parallelogramma. Se invece ci mettete meno, quando andate a sviluppare qui, le norme a quadrato se ne vanno, rimane il doppio prodotto scalare, il doppio prodotto scalare da x e y, qua c'è col meno, ma poi col meno diventa un'altra volta più, il doppio fa 4, vedete 4 per il prodotto scalare. Ok? Allora, da questo cosa segue? Segue che ovviamente se rimangono uguali le norme, ovviamente usando quella rimangono uguali anche i prodotti scalari. Quindi in realtà un'isometria lineare deve essere per forza, su Rn deve essere per forza una matrice ortogonale. Viceversa, una matrice ortogonale è un'isometria lineare. Che l'isometria conserva le distanze, quindi questo è la distanza, la norma di un vettore alla distanza dell'estremo valore limite. Siamo a posto. Ok? Va bene. So. I don't want direct to speak about complex metrics now because otherwise I will get you your ideas to this. I will now prove the Schur's lemma in the real case. We have times we know that eigenvalues lambda 1, lambda n are real. So we have to assume it. We don't know for sure. Change matrix. No. When you have a change of base, the matrix M, we erased it. The matrix M that appears in that position, as in the scheme I drew before, in Italian is called matrice di passaggio. And the English for it exactly, I don't know. I don't know. You can find it. Okay, so is it clear the statement of the theorem? Ma pare che sia chiaro, no? Cioè io ho una matrice A, gli autovalori sono reali, la matrice A è reale, gli autovalori sono reali, io la riesco a triangolarizzare, cioè mi porto tutti gli autovalori sulla diagonale principale con una matrice ortogonale. Of course, this is better result than if I say that I would use a general matrix, because I can specify that this is orthogonal matrix. So this, I can just rotate the base, or rotate plus one change of sign of coordinates, and then I will get that the new matrix is triangular. So, in this particular case, it means that every eigenvalue will be exposed. Okay. How to do it? How to prove it? Proof is by induction. On n. Of course, if n is what is equal to 1, everything is. Now, there is nothing to prove. Because if the matrix has only 1, 1 by 1, it's already declared. Then we have to assume that the theorem is true for a certain dimension n, and then we have to prove it for dimension n plus 1. Okay? So, A is a matrix, n not did any square A. Okay? So, first of all, we find lambda 1 and V1 such that A V1 is equal to lambda 1. Di passaggio I start with the standard canonical base. Then I found one eigenvalue. This can be also defined. You find as the root of A of the characteristic polynomial. Then you find one vector that satisfies this. And then there is what this trick just to have some other vectors. That this will be orthonormal of this. N is orthogonal. I.e. N minus 1 is equal to N. Moreover, n minus 1 a n is this form.
Here you have lambda 1. Here you have all zeros. Here you have some matrix B. And here you have some vector C. Let us call C transpose.
Why? The first
statement
comes from the fact that the orthogonal matrices are precisely the ones that have orthonormal, that their rows, A, that their columns, are orthonormal bases. Okay? Not or just orthogonal, orthonormal. Because if they are not of length 1, when it's not rotation, it's just rotation plus sum. Okay? Even if they are all the same length. If they are different length, it's even worse. But if, even if they are the same length, it's not just rotation, because length is not precise. You. Okay. But in the new base, let us see what does happen. When you take A, you know that this is true. Lambda 1, B1. Lambda 1 with B1. What does it mean? It means this is true. So if we, this is that now, the new base is just that this is the first element of the base, like E1, or the canonical base. But if lambda, if here there was E1 and A, lambda 1, if E1 was A, E1, you know that the first column will be like this. Okay? Because you remember that what is this column? This column are the coordinate of the image of the first vector of the base with respect the vectors of the base. So V1 is the first vector of the base. So here if you put 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, you get lambda 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. But lambda 1 in this base, what it is? Lambda 1, V1. So it's trivial, it's just exercise. Lo ripeto in italiano. Quando voi avete trovato un autovalore e un autovettore, quando avete che A1 sia uguale a lambda 1, che cosa succede nella nuova base? Qual è la matrice della nuova base? Noi sappiamo già che la matrice della nuova base è n-1an. Però sappiamo anche che quando andate a prendere un operatore lineare, un'applicazione lineare, la matrice che rappresenta l'applicazione, da che cosa è data? La prima colonna sono le coordinate dell'immagine del primo vettore della base rispetto alla base. Ok? Allora, se voi prendete buco 1 con il primo vettore della base, le sue coordinate qua sono 1, 0, 0, 0. Quando andate a moltiplicare, qua vi viene lambda 1, 0, 0, 0, perché tutti questi altri numeri si scontrano con gli z, ma lambda 1, 0, 0, 0 a chi corrisponde? Al vettore lambda 1, 1, e vedete che torna. Gli altri non ci interessa, posso venire quello che... L'unico trucco è che il resto della base l'abbiamo preso ortonormale a V1 in maniera tale che la matrice di passaggio fosse ortogonale. È chiaro fino a qui? Qua ci scriviamo C trasposto perché i vettori per convenzione si mettono sempre verticali, quindi quando devo mettere un vettore orizzontale lo penso come verticale, ci metto il segno di trasposto the eigenvalues of B. We found
one eigenvalue for the eigenvalue lambda 1,
so we knew in that the matrix original had these eigenvalues. One we found, B has to have all other eigenvalues. So eigenvalues of B should be lambda 2, lambda n. We knew from the start that these were eigenvalues. We found this. Of course, if you compute the eigenvalues of these matrix are still the same. One comes from here, the others should come from here. Because when you compute eigenvalues, you have that there are the eigenvalues of this time and the eigenvalues of this. The first one is lambda 1, then the others should come from this matrix. Okay. Then I know by induction there exists O orthogonal such that maybe you are not accustomed to call it O, let us call it L R R T R equal to identity and n dimensions and such that L to the minus 1 B R is lambda 2 lambda n 0. Now I will take this matrix. I will take the matrix P. R is n times n. P is like this, 1, 0, 0, R. So, P to the minus 1, it is easy to compute. It is 1, 0, 0, R to the minus 1, it is equal to 1, 0, 0, R plus 2, so it is equal to P. So this is still orthogonal. If you take orthogonal matrix, you add one here, zeros and zeros here, you still get an orthogonal matrix. This is trivial. Make compute multiplication, you will find. Okay? Then, now, I will take M equal M P. Then, which is M to the minus 1? M to the minus 1, it is P to the minus 1, N to the minus 1. But this is equal to P transpose and transpose. And this is the transpose of n. So if I will take this matrix, it's still orthogonal. Let us compute now. M minus 1, A.
minus 1, n minus 1, a, n, b, it is equal to p to the minus 1. Ah, let us write for this p to the minus 1. It is 1, 0, 0, f to the minus 1, then I have lambda 1, ct, 0, b, and then I have 1, 0, 0, r. Okay? This is the central piece I already computed. And then, by construction, this is p to the minus 1, and this is p. Okay? In order not to mess up things, I will just erase the last line. I want to continue here. So, let us first compute the right, I leave the left, no, I can compute first the, let us compute first this times this. So, when I multiply this vector times these columns, I get the first row of, so I will get lambda 1 ct, and then I will get 0 here and r minus 1 b. Why? First row is linear. From the second row on, you can see that when I multiply, I take the scalar of the row with the first column, you get 0. Because in the first place, there is 0 times lambda 1, in the other place, there is something times 0. Then here, we get 0. And in the other places, this ct will be all components of the ct will be multiplied by 0, so it will not affect the product, and I will get just f to the minus 1 c. Okay? And then I still have to multiply times 1, 0, 0, r. Okay? Then what I get? I get lambda 1 transpose this c transpose r, then zeros, and then here I get f minus 1 r. But if you remember, this is lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n, here I have zeros, here I have zeros, and here I have zeros. And here I have some dimension. And this is equal to lambda 1, lambda n. Okay? So I make not serious but big mistake.
you have to plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one, and when there was b here, you have lambda 2, lambda n plus 1, and here plus 1. N matrix and should have n eigenvalues. Lambda 2, if you start with lambda 2, you finish with n, lambda n. Already proved by induction assumption, and you want to prove it for the rest.
But I think that the core computation of the theorem is clear. So when you
apply the first, the previous orthogonal matrix to triangularize B, then you can get this P, you multiply N times P, and you get the matrix B. Oh, so some consideration about real possible computation of this stuff. It is possible, really, to compute this stuff. Yes. It's not a big issue. So this gives, in some way, that if the eigenvalues of a matrix A are real, they are easy to compute. Why? You have one key point here. The one key point here is to compute here one eigenvalue. Okay? And this is always easy to compute, in particular if the eigenvalue is here. Okay? Then still today, but after some further consideration, we will be some effective methods to compute eigenvalues, for example, for symmetric matrices. Okay. This is very easy to compute. You can compute all eigenvalues of symmetric matrices very easily and very efficiently. If you ask MATLAB to compute, you take a big matrix, 1,000 times 1,000 or more, symmetric, real symmetric. Then you ask MATLAB to compute eigenvalues, will not let you to wait long. If you take one convex matrix, it is another picture. It's much more, computation is much more. Okay. Allora, ripeto quello che abbiamo fatto fino a qua. Abbiamo visto la definizione di autovalore e di autovettore. Abbiamo visto gli autovalori e gli autovettori, li studiamo per matrici in Rn o in Gn. Comunque gli autovalori in generale stanno sempre in Gn, perché anche se il polinomio caratteristico, gli autovalori sono radice del polinomio caratteristico, anche qualora il polinomio caratteristico fosse coefficienti reali, gli autovalori potrebbero lo stesso essere complessi. Poi abbiamo visto che gli autovalori sono invarianti quando cambio base negli endomorfismi, cioè invarianti quando moltiplico a sinistra e a destra e ottengo la matrice del tipo M-1AM. M-1AM in generale non si può diagonalizzare. Questo vale per le matrici reali, vale pure per la matrice complessa. Non si può diagonalizzare. Però abbiamo visto questo risultato per le matrici reali, che se una matrice è reale, se tutti gli autovalori sono reali, perché se no non posso fare nulla, non solo posso farla diventare triangolare facendo n meno 1 a n, ma n la posso prendere, faccio m meno 1 a m ed m è una matrice ortogonale, cioè il cambiamento di base è un cambiamento di origine. Quindi io posso ottenere qualcosa in meno, non diagonale ma triangolare, ma specificando ulteriormente che la matrice che uso sia ortogonale. Questo lemma di Schur è un risultato profondo, perché in effetti prima della pausa mi conviene tirare ancora 5 minuti, perché questo lemma di Schur implica il teorema spettrale. Se vi ricordate cosa dice il teorema spettrale, questo lo dovreste conoscere tutti, che dovreste averlo fatto nell'analisi 2. Io do una versione molto semplice del teorema spettrale. Comincio a prendere una matrice A reale simmetrica. Allora già sapete che tutti gli autovalori di A sono reali. Questo poi lo ridimostriamo, ma non lo voglio scrivere adesso. Quindi diciamo gli autovalori di A so the eigenvalues of A are lambda 1 lambda n, they all belongs to R. Then there exists m such that m transpose is equal to m to the minus 1 orthogonal matrix, and m minus 1 a m is equal to lambda 1 lambda n. The proof is trivial. So, in the case of symmetric matrix, you can diagonalize it, and with an orthogonal matrix. Why? Proof is trivial. M minus 1 AM is equal to M transpose AM is equal to M transpose A transpose M. This is equal to the M A M transpose transpose M. This is equal to m a m minus 1 symmetric, but by m minus 1 to the left, m to the right, and m is orthogonal, the new matrix is still symmetric. But Schur's lemma, it says that the new matrix is triangular. But this observation, this remark, says that it is symmetric. So if it is triangular, it means that here there are zeros. Since it is symmetric, there are zeros also here. And so it is diagonal. That's end of story. Then, you get from this theorem, this theorem is not complete. We have one more thing to say. What can you say when you have that this new matrix diagonalized with orthogonal matrix? The eigenvector, this matrix obviously has eigenvalues lambda 1, lambda n, because it's diagonal. And what about eigenvectors? Which are eigenvectors of this matrix? If I take this matrix, the eigenvectors are just the vectors of canonical base. So you see, E1, lambda 1, E1, E2, lambda 2, E2, and so on. So the vectors of the canonical base, they are orthogonal. So the eigenvectors are orthogonal. But since the change of base was orthogonal, what does it mean? That the eigenvectors of A are still orthogonal. If you change base going back, you have orthogonal base E1, E2, En. You rotate it, and you still get orthogonal eigenvectors. So, moreover, we can write here, moreover, if A B1 is equal to lambda 1 B1, A B2 equal to lambda 2 B2, lambda 1 different from lambda 2, and B1 different from no vector B2 then B1 scalar B2 is equal to 0. This is still not so precise as what I told. What I told was more precise. I can find, because I can still have the same eigenvalue repeated many times, but in any case I can find an orthogonal basis of eigenvectors. Okay. This is true in any case. This we can prove even without this. When you have orthogonal, we have eigenvectors to different eigenvectors. They should be orthogonal. No. If you have, let us take identity matrix. Identity matrix has one eigenvalue 1, we did it many times, and all vectors are eigenvectors. Are all vectors orthogonal? Not. So it is not true that all eigenvectors are orthogonal. When eigenvectors are eigenvectors with respect to different eigenvalues, they are forced to be orthogonal. But still, when I have all eigenvectors, for example, for 1, then I can find an orthogonal base of these eigenvectors and so on. So, here, more precisely, I should say that we can find an orthogonal base of Rn made by eigenvectors of A. It's better to write. Right here.
lambda, and such that base of Rn orthonormal is not necessary. I wanted just to say that these were not, they are orthogonal, and they each eigenvector should be eigenvector with this type one. Okay. So this is spectral theory, and this is direct consequence of Schur's lemma. You saw, maybe you saw the proof of this theorem already, but if you saw it, was maybe a little bit more complicated. Was still by induction, but a little bit more complicated. If I used Schur's lemma, it's even simpler.